With us again now from New York, Virginia Apuzzo and Dan Bradley, and here in Washington, ABC News political director Hal Bruno. Hal, as we both know, there was a time in this country when politicians might privately court the Jewish vote, the black vote, but didn't publicly want to acknowledge it. They took the money, as Betsy Aaron put it, and they would run. Is that where we are right now when it comes to gay politics in this country?
It's not a bad comparison at all, Ted. I think in order for gay politics to become a national political force, other than an isolated or scattered thing that it is today, a combination of things have to happen one after the other. First of all, you have to have a gay population in a place that's willing to come out and identify itself to be in the open. It's got to be willing to organize politically and to take part as an identifiable voting bloc. Along with that, public attitudes have to change, because until public attitudes change, the attitudes of politicians will not change. And until that happens all over America, rather than in the few places that we've seen, I think gay politics has to remain a localized phenomenon.
All right. Ms. Apuzzo and Mr. Bradley, first of all, let me ask you to pick up what Hal Bruno has said and ask you whether you agree with it. Is this, first of all, as far as you are concerned, a localized issue, or do you consider it to be a national trend?
Well, Ted, one of the things I would point out is that in 1976, there were four openly gay or lesbian delegates to the Democratic National Convention. Four. In 1980, there were 77. Consider, if you will, that most of these folks had to be elected, and had to be elected by caucuses around the country. And they came from states all over the Union. I believe there was something like 24 states. It seems to me that one of the things that that Mr. Bruno was overlooking is the fact that there is a concerted effort on the part of the gay community to dig in local areas and to become part of the political process in their local areas and to be able to be elected to representative forums where their issue does become part of the national agenda. I think that's happening. And I think his point about creating linkages across the country is well taken. But again, we have to look at how much can happen in so short a period of time.
Dan Bradley, let me ask you about the other point that Hal Bruno raised, and that is the issue of people publicly being willing to identify themselves with any gay cause.
Since I came out of the closet and resigned my position in Washington a few months ago, I've spent the entire summer traveling north, east, south, and west in behalf of the Human Rights Campaign Fund and the Gay Rights National Lobby. And I think, in response to one observation that Hal made, there are millions and millions and millions of gay men and lesbians in this country. Unfortunately, because of fear, prejudice, and discrimination, most of us, unfortunately, are still in the closet. But let me tell Hal one thing, and I speak from experience. The largest closet in America is the privacy of the voting booth on election day. And I can tell you, because I've been to Mississippi, I've been to Little Rock, I've been to Jackson, I've been all over the South, and I'll tell you what's happening. Gay and lesbian voters are participating in the political process more so than they have ever done so in the past. They have not come out of the closet publicly, but the fact that we are giving them a vehicle, we're giving them an opportunity to know that nationally, gay and lesbian people are organizing and are participating in the political process. Those persons are going to the polls and they're voting for that candidate that we can tell them do support gay and lesbian rights. It's a phenomenon.
Let me interrupt you for a moment. At the moment, you're still just talking about candidates who support gay and lesbian rights. You're not talking about candidates who are themselves gay or lesbian. Why not?
If I may, Ted, I think that we are at a stage in our development where we are much more able to elect than electable. I don't think that period will last terribly long. I think every minority group has gone through that period. But for right now, we see it's real possible to affect who the representative is. When we will actually become our own representatives, I think is in the near future.